Good. We're off and running here. It's working. Very great. So, wow, allow, then wow. Okay, that's the secret. Wow, allow, and wow. I didn't post my last video because it caused me too much concern. Like, wow, I'm not backing off enough. And I have to do a better job of backing away. It's like a Maverick surf contest. They don't allow the spectators anymore. You have to watch it online. It's too dangerous for the spectators. Right now, it's too dangerous to do something. I don't know exactly how it is, but I can feel it's too dangerous. The facade of spirituality that the world has got into is just a facade. And just beneath that surface, still the same. It takes a lifetime of effort to really get to it, past the facade, and really change our expectations. So we haven't got to it. We haven't got as far, I mean the world has not got to it, has not gotten to it at all. So what you have is the spiritual materialism, which is extremely dangerous, because it can seem like spiritual, but then the demands will be non-spiritual, will be delusional demands. And this is quite dangerous situation. So, as I say, take refuge from it. And it's difficult to know exactly what to do now. I backed off Facebook already, and I may have to back off YouTube. That is possible, yeah. I don't know what's going to happen. But I can certainly feel, if I'm not going the right direction, I can feel like, whoa, that's too dangerous. It's tough for us because we put a lot of effort into our life here, right? To try and encourage everyone to really live a dharmic life of practice. And so for me, I just assume, well, many have done so, but Maybe not, actually. The evidence is that it has not happened, which means we have to take a longer point of view and start planning for the future. I mean, most people in this world will have at least another life, and most will have more than one life, actually. So you might say there's a few that might have just one more life. It could be very rare for those, this is their final life. For me, it's my final life. Because I've been able to get to the central issue, really. But it's not easy to get there. Now, looking back, I realize, wow, it's very difficult. Creation is non-causative. You have to understand this. It's this. We're having a dream of causation to cast doubt upon non-causation. But for most, this is so abstract. They just, you know, they can't. They don't. They're not prepared to just allow and wow this. I was able to see this morning. And I say, okay, wow. I didn't try to turn it into some concept, or intellectual construct, or structure. I just saw the overall layout of it and just say, oh, yeah, this is true, okay, wow. It takes a lifetime of being like a hermit, of being patient and just allowing, accepting, gradually accepting. It's very difficult, but it's very doable. All you have to do is to apply your time, effort, attention to it in a steady, determined way. That's all. But anything less than that isn't going to work. And we seem to be living in the age of distraction, because there's so much fake causation being brought into the world. Technology is bringing all this fake causation. There's no causation at all. Reality is uncaused, no causation taking place. The nature of God is freedom from all causation, no causation. Meaning everything is simultaneous in the now. There's nothing, no moment causing another moment at all in reality. So it's no causation is taking place. That's creation. And that always remains so. So this dream of causation, which we call a world, bodies and world, this is just it's a dream. It's completely make-believe. And even this dream is free of, doesn't have any causation. Meaning, again, that our desire and the experience are one and the same. There's no separation between the two that we could claim as causation. A process. There's no process involved. There's no time involved. See, the time, space, process, and form is a dream that we're having. We're imagining this to try and cast doubt upon reality and say, no, there's some causation in reality, so that we can pretend that we're greater than God, that we've actually added on to what we are. We've added on causation to what we are. So, but this issue is something that just has to emerge in the context of your practicing. It is not an intellectual concept to be grasped. I've never understood, you know, up to this point. I don't get it. But I keep practicing. Okay, I know it's just my expectations is the whole problem. Familiarity with expectations is our only problem. So I just work from the angle of expectations. I was able to allow my expectations to start practicing. And I just said, I expect to just be, what I expect to be engaged in is simply enjoying uncaused happiness. That's what I expect. I start practicing this way. This is my expectation. And then it dawned upon me the nature of reality and the nature of this dream. And I was just able to just say, okay, obviously this is what's going on. And just, okay. But so the practice is always with our expectations. It's not with grasping intellectual concepts. We do mention these concepts because we're so used to structure. But it's always about practicing. The real practice is with our expectations, and then the truth will just dawn upon us, and we'll just say, oh, of course, that's it. So it can never be the other way around. We'll never get there through just devouring intellectual concepts. We'll never get there that way. Because we're not treating our problem. We're still believing that non-causation is caused, is caused, instead of just is. And we haven't changed our expectations to experiencing this, just experiencing this. We still expect to be intellectually devouring something, right? So we really haven't gotten to the path at all in that way. We're still curious about how causation will turn out. That's like saying, how does the ocean turn out? How's the ocean? It's like watching waves and saying, I wonder how the ocean is going to turn out. There's no turnout for the ocean, is there? Not really. And just imagine all of reality is like this just one vast ocean. And we ask, well, how's this ocean going to turn out? As we watch the play of waves, we're focused on how is the ocean going to turn out? It's always going to be the ocean. There's no turnout for it. There's nothing causing it to change. There's no causation. So how can it change? There's just ornamentation of it. But our mistake is to say, well, how is this ornamentation going to change the ocean? So really, it's your practicing, full stop in the wow. Wow, allow, wow. Go into your practicing, I'm committed to no action, then this will clarity will arise for you. When you commit to no action, clarity will arise for you. And then after clarity arises, you take no action. You don't build any plans, no causation. You don't throw any causation into what you saw. But you just sit there patiently and let the shock subside. So this practice has certainly worked for me. But rare is it in the world that there are those who practice just simply on familiarity, realizing it's our expectations that are controlling us, is the trouble. And our fear of changing expectations towards uncausedness. Wow, a bird just came here, right next to me, and the cat is trying to get at this. Let me see what's going on here. And it fluttered right by my feet here. And I don't know where it is. It came here for protection. I better take a look at what's going on here. Okay, so one second here. As you just allow yourself, say, okay, I'm committed to wow. I wonder if it was a baby bird and the cat caught it and it got escaped and it was going through here. Well, I said I'm committed to no action, but if there's a, well, I'll see if I can stay here and just be aware if the cat comes close, I will scare it away. The bird came in right by my feet and then fluttered underneath here. So usually birds don't do that, so it's probably injured. Of course, all injury is a dream. All vulnerability is a dream. It implies causation, something acting upon something else to change it. There's no causation in reality at all. Reality is non-causal, completely non-causal, because the desire to experience in our freedom and the experiencing are one and the same. Well, sure, without the desire to experience, there would not be ornamentation, but there's no separation, no causal separation taking place. But this is not an intellectual concept to be grasped. So the only way to practice is adjusting our expectations of what is it we're going to experience. If we think we're going to be experience caused happiness, we're deluded. And we'll continue on with life after life after life, thinking that we're going towards ultimate happiness, that we'll find the right cause for happiness. We'll be able to cause our happiness properly. But the truth is that happiness is uncaused, always uncaused. So we've been barking up the wrong tree entirely. Barking up the wrong tree entirely. Yeah, so it's difficult to turn around this ship, right? A ship of expectations. We're so used to barking up the wrong tree, we just keep doing it, keep expecting. You know, how can I cause my happiness? No, we should do is say, I expect to be experiencing uncaused happiness and the beautiful play of ornamentation that arises around that. That's what I expect to be doing, so to speak. That's what I expect. And expect that. So we have to work at the level of expectations. Okay, this is where the real liberation comes from. It does not come from merely toiling in the fields of concepts. Will not ever come from that. And working with familiarity, we keep thinking, well, nothing's happening. I'm not causing anything to happen. Exactly right. No action is the answer. No causation is the answer. So we're getting familiar with not trying to cause happiness. And you think, well, I'll be unhappy then. No. We'll experience uncaused happiness, which is not subject to being changed or attacked. It's invulnerable. That's called abidance. We'll get familiar with uncaused happiness, that's all. It's the attempt to cause happiness, which is misery. Because we can never cause happiness. So really, and then we're also very fearful of losing, you know, giving up. We feel like, well, I'm going to give up this effort. Then we think, oh, I'm going to lose happiness. I'm going to go in an abyss of despair. So always fear, the dream of causation always is fearful. It's always fearful. There's no way it cannot be fearful. Because we have to abandon it. And our expectations say, wait a minute, I'll cease to exist if I don't know what to expect. So what we have to do is say, I expect to experience uncaused happiness. So we know what we our expectations are set on that. And so there's no abyss. We'll be experiencing uncaused happiness. Our educational system has given us all the wrong set of expectations, and we think that we need to somehow cause our happiness by getting an A in the class, and so we want to show a teacher, well, I'm not struggling. No, I get it, because we want to show, yeah, I got a teacher like that. That's totally mistaken. We shouldn't put on any. We're not trying to get an A from any teacher at all. That's why it's very dangerous to be a teacher in this world. As people that try to please you, like, I need to get an A. No, just say, I'm getting an F. It's already an F. Okay. All my grades are F. Fail. But guess what? You don't need any grades. No grade at all. Uncaused happiness. There's no grade to get it. So just accept that you're a failed student. Of causation, completely failed student, and start your practice that way, and say, well, that's okay, I completely failed to cause happiness, failure, good, so now I change my expectations to what do I expect? Well, I expect to experience uncaused happiness. We had a cat, that last cat we had was uncaused happiness. It was always happy. It always say, cat, why are you so happy? We don't understand why you're so happy. And the cat would just look at me like that, and just, because it knew what I was saying. And then it would just like smile and just go back. And it says, no reason at all, the cat would say. There's no reason for my happiness. Nothing's causing it. And it was always blissful. Even with cancer dying, it was happy. It was like Rama Harshi cat. I said, cat, you're still blissful, aren't you? In those last moments, it was still purring, looking at me and purring and saying, nah, I'm still happy. My happiness is not caused by this body at all. I say, wow. The cat is buried right here, right in front, right 3 feet away from me. The body at least is, but the cat still lives because it's visited me in dreams many times, and it's still blissfully happy, uncaused. Now this information dawns upon us very, very slowly because our expectations keep pulling us away. The fear that our expectations won't be met, we think it's an abyss, so we have continuity fear, like, whoa, I'm not used to this. I might experience an abyss. It's so frightening. But we can go a little faster if we really get it and practice properly, then certainly we'll go a lot faster, no question about it. In going faster, you have to be dedicated to your practicing because you have to apply the wow, wow. Don't throw any causation around the insights. Don't throw any causation into the future. Just let them settle in right now. Don't apply any expectations of causation around the insights. Don't say, okay, well, this insight is going to cause this. Or I need to, it's going to cause this, that kind of action. Don't plan any action at all around the insights that arrive. This is the key. This is the key. This practice really is the key to go really fast. I've tried other ways and it was very slow. This way is very fast. But the problem with the slow ways is you eventually burn out and you just, it's not fast enough. And then you quit. If you don't have the fast way, you end up quitting. This is what happens. So I've looked at all the various ways and the speed of it, and then I realized, you know, it's, you have to, the world is such that you must feel that you're going fast away from the dream of causation. Because the dream of causation is always, seems to be frantically boosterish of itself, right? And so I warned everyone this lifetime, I warned everyone there'll come a time when if you haven't prepared ahead of time, you're going to be lost in a sea of imaginary causation. There'll be so much causation, imaginary, that you'll be trying to sort through, well, what causation is going to cause my happiness? And the very effort to sort through it all will cause you extreme despair. You'll say, I'll never be able to figure it out. This is the danger of these times. It's an extraordinarily dangerous time. And I advise everyone to go to a reduced intensity zone where there's so not so much possibilities of causation present. You might say, oh, that tree might cause my happiness. Or that lawn might cause my happiness. Like a golf course. Maybe making this putt will cause my happiness. I don't know. But there's very few things that we need to look at to cause our happiness. So we're not frantic. We just say, well, it doesn't cause my happiness, but there's only a few things, so I don't need to spend all my effort trying to sort out trillions of possible causes. So maybe I can just listen and say, oh, my happiness is uncaused. Oh, that's possible. So you see the complexity of this world now and the technology that's presenting just constant new innovation. You get a car and everything's changed. You know, it's so many, many, many different things. Constantly everything is changing. Options, this will make you happy. You know, the seat now does this. The car now does this. You say, oh, maybe that'll make me happy. But every time you go into a store, all the merchandise has changed. All the styles have changed. I think, well, maybe this will make me happy. So you get dragged into the muck of almost infinite possibilities that you think you have to somehow divine, you know, out of all of that, what's the combinations that will make you happy? And there's like infinite combinations and more all the, constantly, exponentially more all the time. This will cause you to just feel, you know, oh, maybe just dying will make me happy. I just gotta get away from this. I just gotta die. You know, you end up in despair. And so I was told, warned about these times, and I then passed the warning on to as much as I could. I don't know if anyone has listened, actually. Some have that feeling, yes. So some, to some extent, you know, I don't know to what extent, there's been some awareness of this, but as far as really nailing it, I mean, we're in those times now. I'm not pleased with the new car, at all. I said, I'd much rather have an old car. There's only a few things that can go wrong. And a few things that maybe this will make me happy. You know, the cars I used to have was all about, maybe if I drive to this place, I'll be happy. It wasn't about the car. We didn't expect the car to make us happy. We just expected, you know, this car can drive me to the beach and maybe I'll be happy at the beach. Maybe if it's a nice day, I'll be happy. Maybe if it isn't, I won't be so happy. Okay, but at least I'm just looking at a couple things. And so people were way less in despair in the past. Because, I mean, they would ultimately say, well, maybe I better die because I can't find it yet. But their lives were not mentally, we didn't suffer from mental illness so much back then because the options were so few. When you say, well, maybe this dinner will make me happy. No, it didn't. Maybe the next one will make me happy. And that's, you know, it was very simple. And we think of them as barbarians, but because they didn't have so much choices to what could make them happy. But we're really the barbarians now, because we're going into extreme despair. So it's way better to have a simple world than a super complex one, actually, from the spiritual standpoint. Because you can say, well, what could I do today? Well, maybe the dinner will make me happy, maybe not. I don't know. So in the meantime, let me work on changing my expectations. It's like that. That's why poverty is so helpful. You really can't do so many things. I mean, I say, well, maybe if I can't say, well, maybe if I go to Hawaii, I'll be happy. I'm always saying that. But I say, I don't have anybody to. So it's not going to happen. So I said, wow, all those things that I think maybe will make me happy, I can't do. Whereas if you're wealthy, you keep pursuing all this stuff. And you end up really a mess. You never practice spiritually. But here I say, well, I can't really do anything to pursue happiness. So I might as well see if I can change my expectations to uncaused happiness. That's why in a cave is so helpful. You're in a cave, you're committed to just a cave. And you say, well, there's pretty much this fire, you know. This fire's all I got, so... is this fire really making me happy? No, it could go out. You know, I got to keep it going. So that's not really my... So maybe I need to focus on uncaused happiness. You know, change my expectations there. But it's not as difficult to do, right? So it's possible that many people in this world will be headed towards a much more basic, primitive world. Very possible. And the teaching there will be, you know, much, much easier. You'll have a much easier time. You'll be able to actually start adjusting your expectations towards uncaused happiness. Now I say, Jesus tells us that we don't even have to die to leave this world. The body doesn't have to die to leave this world. We don't have to leave this world through death at all, he says. So is it possible to go to a reduced intensity zone where there's very few options? You know, things are very nice, but you know, you could say, well, the search can die down. The search becomes, oh, I don't have so much to search through. Maybe just sitting here will make me happy. Well, I'm not quite happy, so let me settle down and let the search settle down. So sitting in the cave in the Himalayas makes it much easier. There's no question about it. If you're willing to do that. Right? If that doesn't cause you just extreme despair, you can say, well, all the options for happiness aren't here, so this is terrible. I'm bound to be unhappy here. Well, or you can say, I can adjust my expectations to experience uncaused happiness. I'm going to be experiencing uncaused happiness. There's no such thing as caused happiness at all. We keep thinking the caused happiness will be even greater. No, there's no such thing as caused happiness. It's only caused unhappiness. That the search for caused happiness is unhappiness. That's all that it ever has, will be, ever been. It's only been unhappiness, is really despair. Mental affliction. We're trying to be greater than God. You know, greater than God created something separate and different. And that's only misery. It's only misery. All we've experienced in our search for caused happiness is misery. That's it. For me, I could say it. I've been miserable ever since I started agreeing to search for caused happiness. I've been miserable, for sure. No doubt about it. Every moment has been misery. So accepting non-causation that's when happiness will dawn upon us. We'll experience the happiness of non-causation. There's not happiness separate from non-causation. It doesn't exist. And people are just battling in the world over, you know, what's going to cause happiness. This is my agenda. This will cause you happiness. And then other people say, no, 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 our agenda will cause happiness. So they're both barking up the same wrong tree of causation, equally, right? Any barking up the tree of causation is the same as any other barking. It's the same tree. Who cares what the bark sounds like? All dogs' bark sound a little different, right? But they're all barking up the tree of causation, which is a false tree. It's a tree of misery. So we don't need to draw any differentiation there at all. That's total distraction. Someone says, well, I have a beautiful form of causation, and that'll really cause us all to be happy, at least in the future at some point. How could there be a future? Non-causation, how could there be a future in non-causation? Nothing is being caused. No time is being caused. There's just this immediate moment. There's just the isness, the perpetual isness. So when we get the glimpse of you know, absence of causation, you can say emptiness. Buddhism calls it emptiness. What's it mean? Empty of causation. There's no causation. But it's not even empty. It's just there's never been any causation. It's not like we emptied it out of causation. It's never been there. And it's not like in contrast to the world of causation. There's no causation taking place. There's never been any causation. So it's just means empty of causation with these caveats, you know, to it's not that okay, what happened to it? Or we did something to get rid of it. We dissolved causation. No, that never takes place. That means that non-causation would be caused. We caused it, which means we think we're greater than God. So that doesn't work that way. So academically, you can't profit from the terminology of religion, you know, it's emptiness. You can't really benefit from it, which is why I try to avoid it. Those buzzwords like that, empty, which I say, wow, is better than say emptiness. Emptiness starts taking you on an academic trip, trying to figure out emptiness. It's much better to just wow. I experienced. And I said, oh, so this is what Buddhism would call emptiness. I said, okay, but I don't, you know, that's a label that gets you into trouble, isn't it? Ross? 1 minute, please. So there was the classic interruption, which was someone was telling me, well, you got to plan your day. How are you going to be happy if you don't plan your day? Let me help you plan your day. When are you going to do this? When are you going to do this? And I just said, no, 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 no. But just see what happens. I'm not making any plans for the day. You see, we're planning. We're saying, okay, what do I need to do to make myself happy? What do I need to do to find happiness? See, we're practicing taking no action because happiness is uncaused. This is the key insight. This is the heart. This is apex yoga, actually. Apex yoga. It's true Dzogchen, true apex yoga, true Longchenpa, true Padmasambhava, true Jesus Christ, what we're doing here. Now, I might do something later in the day, just to spend some time, this and that, but I don't have my mind on it. I have my mind on the practicing here and let everything else fall in place around that. I might just look at some ornamentation of this and that, but is that going to cause happiness? No. All happiness is uncaused. There's no happiness that is ever caused at all. None. So you can see how I say everyone in the world is barking up the wrong tree. They're all totally deluded, actually. This is so. They just think, the world thinks that there's so many more options to search in that the possibility to find happiness is increasing. They think the odds are increasing because, you know, there's just like, I have a million styles of clothes to choose from. So before I had a few and that didn't make me happy. But now I have so many that I'm feeling like optimistic, like at some point I might be able to find what works. I actually put myself through a sadhana, lila sadhana, with that at one point in my life. And I finally glumly said, oh my gosh, you know, doesn't matter what combination of clothes you wear. You could go to an apartment store and try on clothes all day. Some people do. Maybe I'll buy a few things. Just go through thousands and thousands of combinations if you do it enough. And nothing quite works. Think, well, I'm happy. No, it didn't quite. It's not quite happiness. You know, it's not. No. So it's that way with everything now. From cradle to grave, we're surrounded by materiality, you know, just endless options. Think about it, from children now, how as they go through life, don't you think that the products that are coming out will just be millions upon millions upon millions, and they'll just get more and more and more and more, right? And we say, don't worry, you know, you have a good chance for happiness, to find happiness in this life. Well, you know, utter delusion is actually, you're only going to find misery in that way. But people are angry right now, say, wait a minute, this is, I'm finally seeing the possibility of this great prosperity, you know. And we have it the way we want it. We just need the right leader to assure us that we'll find it. That's the thing. So we blame the leadership here or there, saying, that's not the right tone, you're not saying the right tone of confidence that we'll find happiness. We want this tone or that tone. So that too is misery. Like, say, I just find the right leader who will tell me, yeah, this is how your search for happiness needs to go. It needs to go this way in causation. And you think, okay, that's going to succeed. So we get really rattled when there's leadership changes. I say, well, I don't like that tone. You know, it's nervous about it. It's all barking up the wrong tree, 100%. And so it's not like you say, well, I'm looking for just happiness is just caused with this little tiny causation. It's just a simple causation, super simple causation. It's the same wrong tree. It's barking up the same wrong tree as if we say, well, if I just correlate millions of these causes, this dance of causation, super complex, that's what caused it. It's exactly the same mistake. And we just simply go back and forth around and around in circles between searching for a simple cause of happiness and searching for a complex cause of happiness. It's exactly the same mistake, exactly the same search. So we will find ourselves in a complex world like this one, or even more complex world as it's going towards super complex, or we'll find ourselves maybe in a simple world, searching for that. Now, It's true if that when you want to back away from the search, that a simpler world can seem to help if we don't make the mistake of thinking that it's easier now to find a simple cause of happiness. Then if you make that mistake, you're going to end up you'll end up going back toward a complex towards complexity again, and you're just transmigrating around in circles. You're just going in circles. Just see this and just say, wow. Don't let this become a cause for additional search. I say, okay, I think I got the search now. I think I understand the search. No, it's our expectations. We need to turn it towards, okay, I am now experiencing uncaused happiness. And so we have to educate our expectations. It's very important to familiarize ourselves with a new set of expectations so we can act as if we are experiencing it. Like, now I'm experiencing uncaused happiness, and I expect to experience that all day today. So this is the right way of practice. Get up in the morning and say, I expect to experience uncaused happiness all day today, and it'll actually last through the night too. Just for today, I expect to be experiencing uncaused happiness all day. And we can start out like that. Don't try to make it like all year, all my life to start out. We'll just say, today, I expect to be experiencing uncaused happiness. Now, we can also do another practice. And because we're so used to causation, and we know the trap is both complex causation of happiness and super simple causation of happiness. That's the same trap. So, but we say, well, how, we're so used to, what do I do with this? I can't seem to drop causation altogether, so difficult. What we do is we say, wow, is causing. Okay, we'll give one cause for happiness. We're not saying it's simple. We're not saying it's complex. We're just saying it's wow. So wow is causing the happiness. So it's like a completely abstract way, and we get used to this. It cancels out both simple and complex. And then once we've gotten free of the addiction of searching and thinking there's a difference between simplicity and complexity in the search, then it's very easy from that point to accept that it's uncaused. So like, wow is a bridge. Wow is a bridge. It's the bridge to finally accepting happiness is uncaused and expecting to experience uncaused happiness. So we just use this to block. It's like Ramana said, use one thought to block all others. This is very, it's the same principle. We use one causation of happiness to block all others. Wow is causing my happiness. Now, it's true that we might say, well, something is causing this wow, but we don't say, well, this what's causing my wow is really responsible for my happiness. It's just reminding me that wow is causing my happiness. So that's a nice reminder that wow is causing my happiness. It's just a reminder. It's not a cause. So if we see a beautiful ocean, it's not causing our wow. It's reminding us of our wow. Okay, so this is a sh so we're shifting our expectations and our practicing. This is what we have to do. We have to keep shifting our expectations. Turn it this way. Keep turning it this way. This is called skillful means. So here we have this beautiful ocean, and we're saying, wow. And then tell yourself, okay, wow is causing my happiness. That's right. Okay, thank you for the reminder, ocean. Thank you for the reminder, world. Thank you for the reminder that it's that you know, wow, you're not causing my happiness. Wow is causing my happiness. Right. Thank you for that. So view all beauty of the world, everything sublime, is just a reminder that wow is causing your happiness. So if you listen to some music, you say, wow. And then say, oh, okay, that's just a reminder. Wow is causing my happiness. And get back to that. So this is, then you're being dharmic, okay? If you say, oh, the symphony is causing my happiness, you're being non-dharmic, for sure. Or of this art is causing my happiness, or this beautiful nature, oh, look at this, this is causing my happiness. That is very non-dharmic. And you're just, again, will find yourselves chasing your tail, chasing the tail of misery. But if you say, oh, look at Yosemite, look at this beautiful expanse, you say, wow, wow, oh yeah, thank you, Yosemite, for the reminder that wow causes my happiness and nothing else. And so use everything, and then you get back to your practicing of adjusting your expectations. Only one cause of happiness, which is wow. So these reminders of the world can then be a reminder of wow is causing my happiness. And it's only a reminder. So there's a beautiful way to be in the world. This is maybe what Jesus is telling us, that there's a way to use an easy way, a path. I know I was kind of like saying, I don't know, Jesus is pretty difficult. Well, it's difficult to do this. Yeah, if you don't do it, it's difficult, but it's possible to do this. Once you see very clearly, I was saying, A Course in Miracles is difficult to get to this. Well, yeah, because we're so far away from that. But what Jesus is saying is you can get to this. You can. And so we have gotten to it. So Jesus is right again. He's right again. This is what he's getting at. It is possible to be in this world without valuing the world as a cause of your happiness. But we can value it as a reminder of wow is causing our happiness. And then ultimately, it's the illusion that blocks all other illusions. And once we get used to them, there's just this one illusion, then it's going to be so easy for us to just say, to accept that happiness is uncaused. There's no cause for it at all. It's uncaused, perpetually uncaused. It's the uncaused nature of reality itself is happiness. That's what happiness is, actually. But first, we need to back off the search. And we do that by just accepting, relentlessly accepting just one cause and no other. One thought and no other. That's why Ramana said, just the I thought, or Nisargadatta said, just the I am feeling. Just I am. It's the only feeling. He did it through feeling. The only feeling there is that causes my happiness is I am. So all he did was I am is causing my happiness. Okay. And he just did this relentlessly. And within about 4 or 5 years, he's just accepted that happiness is uncaused. Okay. So it shows you this practice works, and it works fast. Now, we may not all be like, you know, Nisargadatta Maharaj, who was simply ripe to say, okay, I accept this. This is the practice. I know it'll work, and I'm just going to do it. And that's all he did. Or Ram Maharshi, who just said, okay, I am. I, okay, there's just one thought causing happiness, just I, not I am this, but just I, or I, as he says, just I, and when you do that, this brings you quickly then to the uncaused nature of reality, which is happiness itself. We're not used to we're thinking of happiness as cause, so we can't understand that non-causation, the nature of no causation is happiness. That's what it is. That's what we love to feel. That's the feeling of reality. It's not caused by something happening. It's not caused. It's not caused at all. So we're absolutely on track here. For us, it's not I am or I, it's wow. It's wow. Wow is causing my happiness. Now, why? Because I'm more an aesthetic person. I love beauty. I love beauty in sublime aesthetics. So for us, those who are that way, it's better to use the wow than I am or I. It's better. It's a better approach. But it's the same approach. It's the same approach, but it's just a different vibe to the wow, meaning, oh, I look at this beautiful Pacific Ocean, you know, and then you say, oh, that reminds me, wow, causes my happiness. So if you're drawn to beauty, the wow is a better approach than to say just I or I am. It's more conducive. It's the style. It's our style. Okay. But for others who are drawn towards different focuses, then maybe just I works better for them, or I am will work better for them. Those who are more into mechanical structure, for instance. I'm not into invention and mechanics and any of that stuff. I could care less about it. Me, I just look for beauty. That's it. So wow is works great for this type of mindset. Whereas those who might be into really figuring out structure and coding and how to make this work, and maybe then just I am is better. I. Oh, this reminds me of I. The structure, just I structure. Or this reminds me of I am structure. This structure of a computer reminds me of I am structure. Oh yeah. So use this one structure to block all other thoughts of structure. And for some reason, for instance, like Indians, it works good for them. And as we see, they're super into coding software. I mean, most of the software in the world is done by Indians. So they're really interested in following logic as a way to find happiness. Okay, they're really into that. For me, I'm really into following beauty as a way to happiness. I've never written a line of code in my life, and I'm not the slightest bit interested in doing so. So for those of you who are like this, who are you are into following beauty, searching for beauty, wow is the right way. It really is the right way. This will really work for you. It really will. It's really working for me. And I'm, you know, super aesthetic. I only search for beauty, you know, for happiness. I don't search for machines at all for happiness. How can structure function in terms of how can we code this to do what we want it to do? That never enters my mind. Like how to build a house never enters my mind. For me, it's more like, there's like a decaying house there, you know, old barn. I say, oh, it's so beautiful. Look at the light and look at how the boards are this way. I just see it as beautiful. I don't see it as like, oh my gosh, how can I fix this house? That never occurs to me. It never even occurs to me. So it never occurs to me as how can I fix this world? It's just like, how can I see this world in a beautiful way? That's the only thoughts I really have. You know, how can I make a beautiful song out of this? That's me. I was a composer in my previous life. I'd walk through nature and I'd try to say, how can I put this beauty into a song? And so try to inspire people towards happiness through music. Now, there is structure in music. That is true. That you have to write down the score for the musicians, which was a real pain. But I wanted to help people. I said, I'm willing to put up with that. But you know what I'm getting at. If you're just into beauty, then wow is the way, for sure. So all beauty, just let it remind you, oh yeah, wow, it causes my happiness. And then take your mind off that so-called beauty. Because you know that doesn't cause your happiness. But you do know it does. Wow causes my happiness. And we understand that's an illusion to block all other illusions. So it's a beautiful way of practicing, which Jesus promised us. There is a way to practice that you don't have to be against the world or antagonistic to it. Maybe this is what he was saying. And then social, some people like sociability. Like this conversation is going to cause me happiness. I'm not that way at all. I'm the type that say, you know, walking in the by the beach will cause me happiness. I never look for happiness in conversation with anyone or interaction with anyone. But there are those who are social. So Apparently, A Course in Miracles, Jesus was helping out those who were social. How can you use your socialization to remind you properly? Now, I don't understand that at all, because I'm not social. Just like I don't understand I so much, because I'm not mechanical. So there's like three basic types, kind of, or maybe four: mechanical, social, action, and beauty, I would say. And for me, it's beauty. I'm not one of these, you know, action bungee jumper types, you know. No, not really. For me, it's just all aesthetics. My whole life been totally that way, actually. And trying to do something else, I just don't feel right at all. So, but there are those who are just action. I love action. Action is going to make me happy. So they might say, you know, pow makes me happy. Just pow. Oh yeah, this reminds me, pow. Or aha. Or ah makes me happy. Yeah, they might have something like that. Just ah makes me happy. Okay, or ah, that reminds me of ah. Tibetans use phat, I don't know how to pronounce it. Fat. Fat makes me happy. Fat, it's just, oh, fat. Like, yeah, you know, maybe that's action people. Like, ha! They shoot an arrow, like, oh, hit the bullseye. I say, fat! That reminds me of, fat makes me happy, fat! So that's the Dzogchen, they use that the term, phat, I don't know how it's pronounced. Just say that, and you know, that will help awaken you. That's from an action style, an action. The people in the past were very into action. They had to be to survive. Very few could be aesthetics. Wealthy people can be more aesthetic. I hung around wealthy people previous lifetimes. Maybe was wealthy. You collect art. You collect music. You're into beauty and aesthetics. You have the good life, and you're able to do that. So for that, it's wow. And for those who hustle, bustle, socialization, business. Like, oh, I'm talking, I'm making business deal with him, business deal there, I'm making business, you know, and we're talking, having lunch and stuff. They their approach might be I am makes me happy. Oh, that reminds me, I am. And if you're into really figuring out how nature works, you know, the workings of it, like a science or something, the workings of science, you might say, I. That reminds me, I. That's the workings, I. So, I am, wow, pat. Or, aha. Or, ah. For action, something like that, okay. So this is a good way of looking at it. So we're not so puzzled anymore. Like, why are these different approaches? That's why. Looking at a sunset, you just say, wow. That reminds me of wow. Wow is causing my happiness. And then when we just then reduce it all to just one cause, of just wow, which is what? It's totally nebulous, right? Completely nebulous. Just it's easy to then evaporate. Wow, it's just dissolve. It just dissolves. So easy for it to dissolve at some point, and then you're just there. Oh, uncaused. It's easy. Jesus says it's easy. When you reduce it all to one illusion, then it becomes so easy. Same thing that Ramana Maharshi says. Same thing that Sagardhara Maharaj says. Use one thought to block all other thoughts, one illusion to block other illusions, then it becomes very, very easy. Trust that. So I just trust that. I just trust this will be true. So someone tried to discourage me from this taping by saying, you need to go search for happiness, you know, out in nature. And I said, well, you know, first, let me understand what's going on here. I'm not searching for it. I'm just going along with my habitual tendencies and then practicing the wow from it. So don't try to shift your tendencies. If you're a scientific person, don't try to change into an aesthetic person. No, no, no. Just use the I. Oh, this. I discovered this scientific thing that says, oh, that reminds me, yeah, the I is the answer for happiness. I say, oh, that reminds me, I causes my happiness, causes happiness. You can practice that way, practice that way. So you're not, see, these different ways, and if you're into socialization, just use the I am. Oh, this interaction reminds me of I am causes happiness. Just use that. Don't try to become a scientist if you're a social person, like a business person. And if you're an action person, like a warrior, you use the aha or ah. This reminds me, ah causes happiness. Or yeah, yeah causes happiness. Or yes, 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 yes causes happiness. Just use that. And if you're into beauty, just say, wow, causes happiness. Don't try to change your personality. That's a waste of time. Go directly from wherever you're at. Go directly from wherever you're at. Or there might be one other type, the trickster type, the psychopath type, the trickster psychopath type. And so for them, you might say, maybe, aha, aha, causes my happiness. So there are those who love just, I mean, they seek for happiness by being able to deceive others, trick others, get the better of others in tricky ways. They're always think, how can I find a tricky way to entrap, get the better? And so when they see, like, oh, this a scheme, they're schemers, and they say, oh, I just saw a lovely scheme. It's like, aha. Maybe they can say, aha. So the action, yeah. Socialization, I am. Mechanics, science, I. Beauty, wow. Action, yeah. Causes happiness, yeah. And schemers, aha, causes my happiness. Okay, aha, causes my happiness. You know, the ones who love to watch, like, the murder mysteries and detective stuff. It's like, they're schemers. They say, okay, if I just find the right scheme, the clever scheme, I'm going to be happy. So, aha, causes my happiness. This reminds me that aha causes happiness. Just aha, nothing more. Not these schemes, but aha. There you go. So just identify, you know, you'll know which way is best for you. You know, right? You identify it. You might, you know, fantasize about beauty. Well, then beauty is your thing. Some people fantasize about schemes. So scheming is their thing. Sometimes people fantasize about action. Action is their thing. Some people fantasize about all sorts of relationships and business. Socialization is their thing. Some fantasize about great, you know, inventions and scientific breakthroughs. Then science is your thing, like that. And those who fantasize about all sorts of different ways, well, that's scheming. That's the schemers. What kind of schematic scheme can I come up with? Or it could be, you know, the relationship thing. But get it down to its basics and just discover, you know, what's your way of searching for happiness. and then find just one word or two words, or aha is one word, you say that's causing it, and block all other searching. Say, no, I know what's causing my happiness. For me, wow is causing my happiness. So if I want to go out in the world today, it will only be for the sake of being reminded that wow is causing my happiness. That's it. If I go out on a golf course, it's not the golf that's making me happy. I say, wow. And the beauty is like, oh, wow, it's causing my happiness. Yeah, that's it. Someone's going really fast there on their motorcycle. Their action, right? Yeah. So that's the speed, you know, the action of speed is causing my happiness. But they say yeah, is causing my happiness. Not the speed, it's just reminding me what I'm doing on the motorcycle, just reminding me that yeah is causing my happiness. And of course, people say, well, they're mixtures of this and that, but your basic type, you can easily reduce it. Don't try to make it complicated. That's a schemer. If you try to make it complicated, you're a schemer then. That's your basic way. So if you're not just saying, oh yeah, I know, I'm science is really my way, or beauty, or action, or socialization, then you're a schemer then. That's your way. So schemers just say, aha, that's what caused my happiness. Aha causes my happiness. Not any particular scheme at all, just aha. This, all schemes remind me of that aha causes my happiness. Schemers say, what if I blend this and this and I make it more complex, I'll blend that. That's scheming. So that's the scheming towards mixing and balancing this way and that. Okay, that's a schemer more than a scientist. A scientist is trying to discover the way things work. Schemers are trying to say, well, I want to disguise this, and I want to disguise this, and I don't want to be that, I don't want to be that, I don't want this to be seen. I want it to be disguised. Like, disguise is my, you know, can bring happiness. Complexity is this beautiful disguise. So making a better disguise kind of is happiness. Aha, I see a scheme. You know, I see a scheme, like I could do this with that. And that, a schemer. So aha causes happiness. At any rate, it's the same principle. We all have to get to this practice of just one word. One simple cause, abstract, yeah, aha, wow, I am, very abstract, right? Very nebulous and abstract, but insist, this is causing my happiness for now, this is the only cause of my happiness, it's the only cause for now. Maybe later, I don't know. I might entertain something else. It's possible. I'm not closing the door on that. But for right now, and for the rest of this life, you say, for the rest of this life, this is what's causing my happiness. Look at it like that. So it's a matter of settling down onto just this one word, settling down into it. You might say, well, not this, not this, not this, but you can find one word. You can find it. It doesn't really matter what it is as long as it suits you. It doesn't really matter as long as it suits you and it's abstract, it's nebulous. It could just be causes my happiness. This is the whole secret to success, is one insight settles it out. One cause of happiness causes it all. And then from there, we're able to easily relinquish that and say, oh, actually, it's completely uncaused, totally uncaused. But we have to have this bridge to get there because of our expectations. We must practice and keep educating our expectations towards uncaused happiness. Have to do that. There's no way around that at all. There's no way around right spiritual practice. No way around it. Of course, so schemers think there's a way around it. Whenever they see some scheme around, they say, aha, aha causes my happiness. Okay, so schemers can practice too. There's no excuse for schemers now. We've taken away all excuses for not practicing. The perplexity is that certain types think that everybody's that way, and then they give out remedy for their type, and you're thinking like, how come I'm left out? I don't feel that. I don't feel attraction to that, right? So what I'm saying is, you can find this one word for yourself. You don't have to have a guru tell you what your mantra is. Or the gurus are adept at that. A real guru can give you that one word, which works for you. But you can find it for yourself. I found wow for myself. I mean, the Holy Spirit must have found it for me. But it will occur to you, when you're willing to practice this way, the mantra will be self-revealed, whatever it is. It will be self-revealed. So we're way past, you know, the clumsiness of the early days here now. Like transcendental meditation, I got a mantra down in Santa Barbara then, and there's a TM center there, and there's a big thing, like we're giving out mantras, so like it's like $50 or $25. You could go in, and you have a meeting with one of the TMers, and they ask you a few questions about yourself, and then they kind of, what they're trying to do is figure out your type or something. Then they say, give you a mantra, and they say, okay, your mantra is now, I don't remember what it was. It was like, you know, some Sanskrit thing of mantara or something. You know, I don't know what it was, but just some syllables, Sanskrit syllables. Say, that's your mantra. Don't tell anybody, that's your special mantra. And just practice that every day. Just practice that, just saying that. Well, I mean, that's clumsily kind of resonating, okay, but it's very clumsy. We're way past that. Been there, done that. And for a while, I just said, I don't get it. You know, it just doesn't really resonate with me at all, because I didn't understand. You know what? It wasn't clearly explained at all. They just say, well, settle your mind. That's not really a clear explanation. Here we have a very clear explanation. So we're way beyond the 60s and the 70s and the 80s now. Way beyond it. We have A Course in Miracles and we have radical Dzogchen understanding. We're grounded in that now. So we really, really, we're grounded in the whole non-causality, the truth of non-causality. We need to do nothing at all. So we should just realize, wow, I mean, we're really quite advanced at this point, actually. Quite advanced. So we're not the days of naivete are gone. We're past that, way past it. Yeah, it's still going on in the world. I mean, you start out that way, like, I'm not sure. I need a guru, famous guru to give me a mantra. And, they make a good business out of that. The TM was, business sort of thing. He was a businessman, Maharishi. He's a businessman. And he saw it as a business and socialization and various things. But it was helpful to sort of introduce to the naive. So it was helpful that we at least vaguely, we said, well, there's something we can do if we just meditate. And he said, just all you got to do is meditate and you'll be okay. Yeah. But, and, they introduce some refinements to it, etc. So that will continue on for those who need to get started, but it's like kindergarten, kind of. But for me, there's no interest in that at all for me anymore, really. We're way beyond that. We're now into Dharma kings. Okay, so we're into Padmasambhava, for instance. Okay, so we're advanced. This is advanced, very advanced. But it's because I've gone through all these steps along the way. That was like 1975. Got a mantra from the TM people, Maharishi people. And I said, I got to get with it. And of course, it was being marketed by all these lovely young women. And they said, I'll look upon you as a really hip guy, really cool guy, and like be a very attractive guy if you start practicing TM. And you thought, oh wow, okay, maybe I can be more popular with the young women, my age, because I, of course, as a guy, when you're 18, if you're not one of the jocks or something, you're the women is very unattractive to them. It looks like, what an idiot, it's poor, doesn't have anything going for him, so it's like, don't even exist. Don't even exist. They say, well, I can't find happiness there in that relationship. There's no possibility for it. So don't. But so you're very vulnerable to being marketed to by lovely young women, or maybe vivacious young women, or a combination thereof, or any woman will do, at that age. And it's like if they say that if you join the TM movement, I'm going to find you like you're really. You're on my prospect list, on my radar of maybe you could make me happy, that kind of thing. They say, I know I could make you happy, but maybe you could make me happy too. There's some, possibly relationship. It's possible. And so you're super vulnerable to that, super vulnerable. And of course, the business people like Maharishi, of course they know that. They're business people. They're into relationships, being happy through relationships. So they know how to use marketing like that way. It's just marketing, they say. For them, it's just marketing. And of course, they're getting super rich and popular because of it, and that they think will make them happy. So they think that everybody's winning. And so you're very naive and vulnerable to that. So I didn't like it at all, but there was so much pressure. I was so lost. I said, well, maybe I can become a little popular, like somebody will even like say my name or something. But it didn't work. It didn't work. I was still completely unpopular. Me, I just wanted to look at the sunset every night at Campus Point in Santa Barbara. The best sunsets in the world there. It was just unbelievable. When it wasn't foggy, it was every night evening I'd go out there to Campus Point. Maybe I'd surf and then I'd just watch the sunset, and it's just like, wow, it is so incredible. And that's it. But so I was, still, I'd just go to the beach and watch the waves. But, if there were some women into young women into that, then they might hang out with me. But they still thought like, this guy's not into money at all. So I'll find someone else who's also aesthetic, because I was not, I've never been into money at all. Just 100% aesthetics. I just feel like I could be happy just with, just on an island, just watching the waves or something and the play of light, and I don't need a penny for it. I'm like that. So it's kind of zero prospects there. Which is okay, because you could be completely alone and just watching the ocean. It's fine. You don't need someone there with you, actually. I never felt like I need somebody there, not really. But the lack of popularity, no one pays any attention to you. It does weigh on you a little bit. become vulnerable to marketers saying, "Hey, you could be more popular. All you have to do is do this. Just say this, you know, join the Maharishi movement. Join the TM. Any mantra will do." But not really, you see. You need what suits you, really suits you. So you really, the best mantras are self-revealed. They're revealed to you based on your determination to practice. Then you might shop around and this and that, but settling, like for me, wow. Wow just says it's just perfect for me. It's just, yeah, that's it. I don't need to search around. I don't need om. Okay. I don't need Tibetan syllables or mantras. I have wow. That's it. And Ramana told me, just use what you're coming up with. Just use that. He says it's the same basic practice. Just use it. He told me in about the year 2000 in a dream, he said, just keep doing what you're doing. This is Ram Maharshi directly. I said, Ramana, I said, look, what I'm doing is a different style than what you're doing. I'm worried about it. I'm worried it won't work. And nobody's paying, you know, everyone's paying attention to I, and nobody's paying attention to what I'm doing. And so I'm afraid it might not work for me. And he said, no. I guarantee you it'll work, he said. In fact, I see that you are going to do it, and it will work for you, and you're going to be fabulously helpful in the Dharma. So just keep doing what you're doing. Don't worry about I. He gave me direct permission. He said, don't even think about I. That's not your style. He said, that's just a style that's very popular for the people that came to see me. Okay. But it's not the only style there is. Your style is going to work the same way I would work for somebody else who's really into it. And he guaranteed that for me. See, so my success has been guaranteed by Ram Maharshi. It's been guaranteed by Longchenpa. He guaranteed it. But Ramana was the first one that guaranteed it. So I continued on, and this has developed into this wow practice, which is for those who are very much into aesthetics, the sublime beauty. That's what works. And quibbling doesn't work, okay? Quibbling is not the way. But it helps if you have Ram Maharshi guaranteeing your success. I needed that. I needed it. Because I said, but that's because I was pioneering this. And now that this has been pioneered, it's not nearly as difficult for others. They say, okay, well, there is a way and it works. Whereas for me, I say, Ram, I don't see anybody doing what I'm doing. And he says, well, that's true, but it's going to work for you for sure. So he stepped in, you know. You talk about a great guru. He stepped in. He saw the danger, and he immediately stepped in and said, okay, I see your concern. Let me set your concern to rest for you right here, right now. And he conveyed certainty to me. He conveyed this beautiful certainty to me, which just struck me so strongly. And that set me right. It set me right. Saved my life. No question about it. Saved my life. Because I was, you know, headed towards despair and the wheels coming off. And his certainty was so powerful and so pure that I said, I realized that what he is telling me has to be true. It has to be true. He's absolutely certain about it. There's no wavering at all. And so it had such a profound, it's a dream, it had such profound effect on me that I cited from that moment, okay, I will continue on and with the belief that this will work. But without him stepping in, couldn't really have made it. Because he's the number one teacher right now in the world, Ram Maharshi, for those who really are after true success, right? Yeah, you see so many teachers and they have a picture of Ram Maharshi behind them, right? Because what they're trying to say is, what I'm telling you will certainly work because Ramana is backing it up. Now, having a picture of Ram Maharshi behind you doesn't mean that he has guaranteed your success at all. It doesn't mean that. See, I had direct contact with Ram Maharshi where he explicitly told me what I'm doing is going to work and to keep doing it, even though it's different than what he advised. It's different. So that's not the same thing as somebody. Anyone can put a picture of Ram Maharshi behind them, and then you think that, well, you know, this certain whatever they're teaching will certainly work. Anyone can do that, but that doesn't mean that Ramana is guaranteed that what they're doing is going to work. You know, no, it doesn't. So that's why I confidently continue to do these tapings and tell you, you know, practice this wow, or now I've made it clearer that practice one word that's your type, one reaction that's your type, just one cause of happiness. If you're a scientist, great. You can practice, you know, I. Perhaps, you know, if that works for you, I. Okay, I is causing my happiness. The I structure, I structure is causing my happiness. Ah, I found it. It's the I. You know, you can practice that way. It'll be just as successful as me practicing wow, because I'm into aesthetics. Aesthetics is what I believe will cause my happiness. It'll be just as successful for you. Same thing with all these different types. Even a schemer, like, aha, it'll be just as successful for you as what I'm practicing, as long as you practice diligently, like I'm practicing full stop in the wow. As long as you practice it super diligently. Steady determination is required. Let's make that very clear. Steady determination is required. It's all about one cause of happiness and blocks all the rest. You're not searching any longer for it. You're not searching. And anything in your habits that come up is just a reminder. Sure, a scientist will keep being scientific, right? And schemers will keep being schemers. Right? But whenever you see a scheme, it's like, oh, that reminds me. Aha, it causes my happiness and nothing else. And then right back, you're in practicing. Right away, you're back in practicing. It's like that. So Ramana is right. He said, you're going to be very, very dharmic. He says, I already know it. Very, very dharmic and be very, very helpful. This has come to pass. Because I'm seeing now how to generalize this one principle and apply it to all different types. And so we have this very ecumenical teaching, beautifully ecumenical teaching, free of all the, you know, religious encumbrances, the various encumbrances. It's very streamlined here, very streamlined now, and very clear. But steady determination is required. Without that, there can be no guarantee of results at all. Now, it has to be steady determination, has to be present. But what's stopping you from that? Nothing, right? Nobody can stop you from steady determination. When you are working within the type that you are and not trying to please some other type. See, I'm not trying to please some other type by me, my practice. No, nobody should try to please some other type, because each type should be focusing on their own practice and not trying to change other people over to theirs. I'm not trying to say, hey, scientists, you know, use wow. No, I'm saying scientists use I, okay? Like that, or whatever, you know, works for a scientist. I believe I could work well. I can adjust this or something. But I say, do that, but don't try to tell me I'm supposed to do I. No, I'm a different type. I never think of science. It's just beauty, 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 beauty. I was very much that way. My dad was very much that way too. He was so aesthetically brilliant, you know, as far as beauty. He was just amazing. He saw beauty everywhere, a leaf, and he'd see the leaf, say, oh my gosh, you know, what I can do so many things with this leaf and make it so beautiful in this way and that way and that way. And that's with my camera work. It's just, you know, how can I use a camera to make this look so beautiful? So if you're a camera person, you know, maybe you just, wow, this photo, wow, it just reminds you, wow, 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 just wow, just wow. Just wow causes happiness, and this photo reminded me of that. So you see, you're not lost and forsaken at all, are you? There's this very clear teaching here for you, with the caveat that steady determination is required. See, that can never be done away with. You must use steady determination, but you can do that. You can. And if you do that, nothing can stop you from succeeding. You will then ultimately realize uncaused happiness, the only happiness there is. And you will, your expectations will have been turned, so you expect to experience uncaused happiness. True happiness, the only happiness there is, uncaused happiness. You expect to experience that. And then you will. You will for sure. So this is great good news. This is a much better video than what I did last night. I realized that. I wasn't pleased with it. It was a lot of effort, but I said, I can do better. You know, I can do better. I've got to do better. I've got, and as soon as I said, I'm not going to post it, I suddenly was relaxed and I was released. Said, okay, there's a whole new insight coming, emerging, that is really spot on. So I want to now get into that groove. It's time to get into that groove and stop following the old groove, because this is upgraded. It's very upgraded, seeing these different types, and the whole picture is coming in, you know, it's becoming clear as I saw the uncaused nature of reality, totally non-causal. Reality is totally free of any causation whatsoever, and it always remains that way. We can never impose causation upon reality. It's just wishful thinking on our part. So, wow, it's just amazing. Wow, right? Or I, or I am, the feeling I am, or aha, or yeah, right? Just yeah. Now, your spouse might be, or your significant other, or your friends, they might be different types, right? Yeah, sure, very much so. They may be just business type, you know, or like talking to people. I really love, the social business type. And they can use maybe I am. Oh yeah, I am is what causes my happiness. All my happiness just comes from I am. I am, I am, I am. I just focus on I am. Then I'm focusing on the cause of my happiness now. I am. Nisargadatta Maharaj. And then he realized, and then that too dissolved. And then, you know, he got it. Maharaj got it. Uncaused. Happiness is uncaused. But he didn't quite get what we're talking about here, which is these different types, the clarity of a bigger picture here, right? And Ramana, of course, he understood that, and he told Punjaji about this. I give different teachings to different types. But he said, most of the people come to me are the type of I. That's why I'm giving it out. But that has not been reported properly. I'm reporting it properly here, maybe for one of the few people that's reporting it properly. Most people think that Ramana only said, no, I is the only way. And they're very didactic about dogmatic. The Indians who follow Ramana are very dogmatic about that. And they're wrong. Okay, they just have a certain dogmatism that you know, of lot of scientific dogmatism. They're very dogmatic. Scientists can be very dogmatic. No, I, that's the only way. Yeah, that's what Ramana said. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. He did not. Punjaji, thank God for Punjaji, really helped us get out of that box. I have a lot of love for Punjaji because he's been very helpful. He was a very helpful bridge from Ramana to this new clarity of Dzogchen Course in Miracles, and freeing us from this dogmatic box that the I folks were trying to stuff us into. The scientific people were trying to say, no, we have the science of what Ramana gave us, and it's I, that's it. Not true. And again, Ramana directly came to me and said, it's not true at all, and I want you to do what you're doing. This is my advice, my teaching to you is you focus on the wow. You do that. That is going to work for you. See? So Ramana had to step in. He had to step in to free us from those who are trying to dogmatically pin us down, okay, for what didn't work for us. So gurus do look after their devotees, don't they? Those who are devotees of truth. This is a great example of it. But Punjaji was very helpful also. I finally came across some writings of his that said he had talks with Ramana. He had a lot of talks with him, that it was just him and Ramana, or just a few. And he asked him questions, the right questions, and Ramana said, yeah, and this is why I do that. And Ramana was very clear and explained it very clearly. And then I said, ah, Ramana was not dogmatic at all. In fact, Ramana said, some people think I'm dogmatic, and that's it. He said, I'm not. It's just this is the kind of type that most come to me like are like this. So that's what's going on. But the others, he says, I give them other advice. Sri Srinanda Maimala, same thing. She gave different advice depending on your typology. And she says, just follow the advice I'm giving you. Don't worry about the advice I'm giving someone else. It may seem contrary to what I told you, but that's because the typology of your search for happiness takes on a certain typology. And so this is going to work best for you, to get back to that one cause of happiness and none other, and everything in my life being a reminder of that. Now, most came to her were social types. Okay, social types, business social types. And so she would, you give japa mantra for them, sort of thing, of just do this, just japa thing. It's like you're relating to someone else or talking with someone else. That works best for them. Japa mantra, she was very big on that because of the types that came to her. They're very voluble, talkative, social types. For me, it doesn't work at all. You know, I have no interest in japa mantra because I'm not, most of my life I've been in solitude. I'm a hermit who's into aesthetics, watching the snowfall or something. Just wow, look at the wind, what it does to the snow. Let's slow motion it, let's put it all into slow motion. Oh, it's so beautiful. I don't have anything to say to other people. I'm not social at all. I don't even have any friends. I'm not interested in business at all. So that japa mantra thing, it just doesn't interest me one bit. But wow, does just clicks like that. Wow. Now, if you don't do the wow, you get into big danger. If you're into beauty, get into big danger and you get manipulated, okay? Because someone may appear to be beautiful to you, and then you think they're the cause of your happiness. Their beauty is. And then they can threaten to withhold their beauty from you if you don't do this and this and this and this and this, and then you get enslaved. So those who are, you know, aesthetic, everyone's in danger of being enslaved by having whatever they think is causing them happiness manipulated or taken away from them. So, but if you just say that everything's just a reminder, then, and it's wow that's causing my happiness, and that's just wow, I carry it with me, just a word is causing my happiness. Wow, nobody can manipulate that or take it away from me. So I feel safe. I feel safe and calm. It's a great feeling. It's a great feeling. I'll tell you that. It's tremendous. Go take this to heart. It's so true, isn't it? Especially relationships, Jesus says, very dangerous. And that's when you think some person, whether it's their great socializer, and you think, oh, I you know, this socializing with them is, you know, is cause of my happiness. Then they can start to get kind of weird. And you're like, and what they're doing is they're manipulating you, so that you're starting to feel desperate, like, oh, I'm losing the cause of my happiness. And then Schemers do this, you know, they're very good at this. They say, hey, what is the cause of their happiness? What are they like? And then they scheme to pretend to be the cause of your happiness, and then they start manipulating you to withdraw it from you. And it's like, then you start getting desperate, and then you get enslaved. Sound familiar? Yeah, we're all in that boat, aren't we? We most certainly are. And I get nervous, like the ocean, oh, it's foggy, it's bad, or whatever. Like, oh, I can't go there. Oh, wow. You know, it's caused my happiness. No, wow is the cause of my happiness. I can look at a picture of the ocean, say, oh, wow. I like surf videos, like, oh, wow, that's beautiful. And then, oh, yeah, but wow is reminding me that wow is the cause of my happiness. So it's like, oh, you know, when you start getting this, the world, you no longer feel you're so enslaved. And you say, you know what? I think my freedom, I'm starting to feel my freedom is close, you know. This hideous fear of enslavement and loss of happiness that I've been going through, this awful dream of happiness having causation, is, I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. You really can start to see the light at the end of the tunnel. And that, it's a game changer for you, isn't it? It's a real game changer. Nobody can deprive me of happiness. Happiness is just, you know, wow. That's what's causing it. This beautiful people aren't causing it. Wow is causing it. And I can remind myself of that easily, actually. I can do it directly. Just wow. And the fact that it works also causes a wow. Like, wow, I'm really going towards true beauty. Wow. Causeless beauty. Wow. Last couple nights, when I lay down to sleep, I just allow causeless beauty to arise, and it's just this gorgeous, flowing aesthetics of light and form. It's so abstractly flowing and beautiful. And I'm just watching it in my mind. I just say, wow. And it's just, whatever I turn my attention to, it just melts into this beautiful play of light with form there and yet not having any cause other than just the play of light for beauty's sake at all. And it's just, everything is morphable, you know, totally morphable, effortlessly morphable. And it's just spontaneously arising. So I say wow to that and say, but I don't even need the world for that. Right? Just anything at all can arise for me at any moment. I had this one where we're just going through all these like church-like, cathedral-like forms, and that it was just flowing through past me, and it was just incredibly intricate, more intricate than any cathedral in the world, more beautiful than any cathedrals in the world. It was just a constant flow past me of that, and I was just saying, wow. You know, it makes the Vatican look like a sandbox or something. It was so beautiful and so ornate and so intricate. But it was all completely morphable in any instant. In any instant, I could focus on something and that could morph into some other completely different play. All right? So I felt utterly free that there was no attachment, there was no causation happening at all, except just beauty for its own sake, so to speak. From desiring to just experience beauty directly, but without causation. So I experienced just this 360-degree flow of cathedral-like ornateness and baroqueness and ornamentationness and structural vastness and beauty and arches, you know, abbeys and just gorgeous. Like that. I mean, if you were like into that, you might just, if you're an architect, you would freak out. But see, I'm not. It's beauty for beauty's sake. Everything's morphable. And so what I experienced is like an architect's dream. Yeah, they couldn't handle it because they immediately tried to fixate it. Say, wait a minute, I got to put that down, I blueprint that, and I got to build that. But for me, I have no desire to build anything. So I'm able to experience this beauty without worrying about fixating any part of it. I let it all remain absolutely free, uncaused in the moment. So anything that I'm experiencing in my mind can shift into something completely else, completely different at any instant, and I allow it. I'm not saying, wait a minute, I gotta stop. I say, now you're free. And if I want it to stay for a little while, it will, but I'm not trying to fixate it into causation at all. I'm not trying to make it causative. So it still has this sort of luminous feeling of in the momentness, that at any moment it's completely free to shift into some, morph into something completely else if I want. I want to morph a cathedral into an ocean wave. Instantly it morphs into an ocean wave, a beautiful ocean wave. And then I can play with ocean waves infinitely if I want to. It's like that. So this is just arising in my mental imagery. I'm seeing it, mentally seeing it. I'm just saying, what? Wow. Wow. So you can still see something and it can remain there for you, but it has this quality, it has a quality of perfect non-causation, or perfect impermanence, you might say. It's like you could say reality is perfectly impermanent. There's no permanence to it whatsoever. Absolute impermanence, which allows everything to arise without precluding anything else. In other words, all potentiality remains constantly present. So this is a feeling, this is happiness really, this is what happiness is all potentiality for experiencing beauty is always present in the moment. So I'm looking at this flow of cathedrals. I don't feel like this is somehow preventing me from experiencing something else I want to experience. But all potential is still there each moment. And I don't have to go through any process or time, space to get to that potential. There's no need for time, space at all. No need for time, space at all. Jesus calls us, don't value your experiencing what you see. Don't value. Values to create your death. He says he's very big on this, and Journey Beyond Words is one of the main emphasis really is on don't value. It's valuing that fixates, you say. Well, that's what he's getting at. That's what he's getting at. That doesn't mean you're not experiencing it. Beauty. I enjoyed that journey through endless beautiful cathedrals. Like flowing past me, just I'm just there as awareness experiencing it. But I didn't fixate on it. I let it go when I was just let it all go. And it was all free to be anything else too. So in other words, you don't value anything specific, what Jesus is getting at, any specifics to value that to be creating your happiness. Your happiness is the totality of all potential present always, along with what you're experiencing as far as ornamentation, the ornamentation of pure potentiality, complete potentiality. It's both simultaneously are there. But as soon as you try to set a definition for your happiness, then you've set of your valuing is what Jesus says. You're valuing, and then you've imagine space, time, and process, and form for yourself, and the absence of which you believe will then cause your unhappiness, or what he says, cause your death. That's what he's saying. The death of your happiness. So, he says, just allow everything experience to just flow, which is what I was doing last couple nights. And, my back, I got a little spot of pain. It's weird. But allow your... It's just a flow without valuing it. And that's just a label. But you get what I'm saying. As soon as you try to define your happiness, fixate it, you're saying that something else has to happen . Or if something else happens, you won't be happy. This is not true. Happiness is the totality always. Whatever arises is not precluding anything else, even this instant. So it's all instantaneous. There's no gap where something else has to happen. So some dynamic has to work upon what you're experiencing right now in order to get to the next experiencing. There's no intermediate step. Okay, there's no breakdown that needs to happen. It's not like you need to, the cathedral needs to be demolished in order to experience the morphing into waves. There's none of that. There's none of that. That doesn't exist in reality. It does not exist. And even if you morph, that morphing is also pure potentiality available for that too. Or you could go directly to waves, from a cathedral to instantaneously waves. But if you want to morph it, that too is a sort of a cathedral wave blend. And you might just stay with cathedral wave blend for a while. Say, oh, that's so beautiful. But at any instant, you could experience anything else. And pure potentiality is always present in the now. Absolute impermanence of God. The absolute impermanence. Meaning God never fixates whatever you want experiencing. It's whatever you want. If you want to have the same cathedral experience for trillions of years, you're free to do so. But pure potentiality will always be there if you want to experience something else instantaneously. You would experience something else instantaneously without having to take any step towards modifying what you're experiencing now. No modification is necessary at all. So a morph is not a modification, actually. A blend is a blend, but that blend itself is creative. It is what it is. You're not actually fixating a cathedral and then modifying that, you know, like fragmenting it. There's no fragmentation taking place at all. There's no fragmentation in experiencing in reality, none. Wow. Right, wow. Now, clarity is a type of beauty, isn't it? But according to our types, we might say it differently. Like I said, wow, because I'm relating to the imagery that I'm seeing. It's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. You know, it's just. I said, where is this coming from? It's amazing. And my mind was just able to just produce this just instantly. You take all the most beautiful religious buildings in the world, and my mind was just spontaneously able to present to me even way more beautiful than all of that, and then constantly change it in a beautiful, flowing way. It's like it was effortless. I said, oh, you want a nice church? Okay, here you go. The mind says, here you go. More? Okay, more. Here's more, and here's more, and here's more, and here's more. The mind is not really fractal. That's a mistake. That's a mistake. It's a big mistake. Because fractals always develop out of what's already been there. Right? It's just a continuation. But really, the mind can produce anything instantaneously. It does not have to have any sort of continuity with what came before. I can switch from cathedrals to waves instantly. So it's not really fractal. It's not fractal. It's not true. I know they're trying to tell us that the mind is fractal. That's just a metaphor, kind of. But it's misleading. It's misleading. So you're trying, you know, if don't try to impose structure on reality that way and say it has to function this way. No, it's free. Freedom is not fractile, not at all. You're free to experience whatever you want to experience every instant, or not experience whatever you don't want to experience this instant. That's not what we're looking at. It's both. Because since all potential is available to you, when you're experiencing something, you're also not experiencing everything else. And God being this perfect impermanence, perfect non-causal, perfect impermanence, allows all of that, allows everything to not be experienced. Whatever you don't want to experience is also perfectly not experienced. But you're free to explore what you're not experiencing always. You're always free to that, and also always free to not experience what you're experiencing now. You're also free to do to that for that without any loss of happiness whatsoever. God is the perfect no-thingness, the no-experiencingness, the no-causationness, the no-permanenceness, the emptiness, as Buddhists would refer to all of that. It's just the perfect emptiness, which is a very abstract way of referring to what we just spoke of. The flawless, perfect, eternal emptiness. Meaning, what we just said, perfect non-causality, no causation, no permanence whatsoever, no preference whatsoever. So all the qualities that we're used to associating with God, actually is the opposite. No qualities at all. Except this absolute freedom of experiencing. So I don't like using the term emptiness, because that can pull you back into Buddhism, so to speak. Whereas we're taking the apex approach here, which really is the most advanced way. And when we take this approach, we don't want to be pulled back into the old approaches, okay? We don't. So I try to avoid certain terms that are like triggers you to go back into certain, approach. We're taking the ultra effective, super simple, apex approach. Longchenpa is helping out with that, to say the least. The master of the apex approach, the great adept of the apex approach, has our back on this. And we'll see how much. So, we get to find out, experience this. We get to experience what Longchenpa will do for us. That's quite exciting. And by extension, of course, Padmasambhava and Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro and Manjushri. And, of course, Jesus also is the apex approach, as is Rama Maharshi and Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. So, but Longchenpa is our direct sponsor, you might say, at least my direct sponsor, with the apex approach. But he's directly sponsoring the apex approach, which is what we're taking, whether we're a scientist, a business social person, a schemer, or an active person, or aesthetic person. It's the apex approach works equally for all of us, okay? But we have to take the apex approach, which is what we're doing here. Longchenpa is the great adept of the apex approach. He left Buddhism, essentially, and transcended it. The nine paths. He equated the apex approach sometimes with Ati, which is the ninth path of the graduated approach of Buddhism. But other times he said, no, it's even simpler than that, even more direct than that. Now, I was always predisposed towards this path. I was always super ecumenical, and I didn't like to get boxed in any particular approach at all. So I was very predisposed to this. I had this dream when of Longchenpa coming into this golf shop, and he came in to change out his irons. And he got my attention, and then he left, and then someone came over to me, was helping him, and said, "That's odd." He said that this someone is kind of very, he didn't have any emotion at all. He was just completely even keel, you know, no, and he wanted to trade in his golf irons for these other irons. And he was trading in two irons for just one. He brought two irons in, and he said, "No, I just want one iron for these two." That's what he did, actually, in the dream. And he says, "That's quite odd." And then it caught my attention. I said, "I wonder what's going on." And then I got this very strong push to change my golf irons. And ultimately, I started searching for, what do I do? What do I do? I do. And somehow my search led me, I don't know how it led me there, but it did. And I ended up ordering these golf irons. And the name of these golf irons is Apex. Apex. Apex Pro, actually. So what Longchenpa was getting to is that you're a pro, you're going to be a pro at the Apex approach. That's the name of my golf irons, the Callaway Apex Pro. It's pretty amazing. But I didn't really put that quite all together exactly. I don't know how I ended up with that, but I did. Oh, I know what it was, because they had to get him certain upright lie angle. So I had to look on eBay for, you know, four up, and I couldn't find any four up. So the closest I saw was three up. And that was these clubs. I was the only ones on eBay that was three up. And it was the right set, five through wedge. I didn't want the full three through wedge. I just wanted five through wedge. So it was the only set that was five through wedge, three up. And it turned out to be Callaway Apex Pro. And I read all the reviews on it, and they were super highly recommended by just about everybody, saying, like, this is like the maybe the best combination iron set ever made. It's forged, but it's also forgiving, and it's just, you know, it's fabulous. And some of the better players who have used them said that a lot of reviews said, this is the best set of irons I've ever played. Nothing's even close. So because of all those reviews, and then exactly the right upright lie angle I need, I said, it's a no-brainer, I'm going to do it. And it turns out they're Callaway Apex Pro. Exactly what the spiritual pros were taking, which is to be a real pro at the Apex approach. Turns out that's the name of the golf irons. You can't make this up. It is true. And I had a dream of Longchenpa showing me this. Said, and duality, you know, the graduate approach, dualistic, two irons, we're going to change that in for just one iron, just one word, just wow. Instead of a concept, no, just one wow. It's kind of hard to make a concept out of wow, isn't it? That's the Apex approach. Just say, I, or I am, or yeah, or aha, or ah, you know, aha. It's like one concept that knocks out all others, so to speak, right? So he traded two clubs in for just one. That's the secret to the Apex approach. It really is the secret to it all. So we're doing the Apex approach here. We really are. And then Longchenpa wants me to be, you know, become a pro at the Apex approach. I said, does that mean I got to be good at hitting the irons? I don't know. Maybe that'll go hand in hand, right? Possible. We'll see what he does. You know, we still, you know, still in the up in the air. What's next with Longchenpa and, by extension, Jamyan Khenchi Choka Lodro, Pamasava and Manjushri, and all the Dharma kings? You know, but what is Longchenpa going to do next? I'm open. I don't know. I'm wide open to the next step. It's not possible. I have not been taping for 2 hours. That's not possible. Is it? Is that possible? No, it's not possible. That's unbelievable. I feel like I've only been here for a few minutes, actually, to tell you the truth. There's no way. There is no way. That is just unbelievable. That I cannot believe that. That's astonishing. I mean, I've lost track of time completely. Lost track of time here. Oh my gosh. Wow. I had no sense of time at all. It just timeless. I felt it's been timeless. I can't believe it's been 2 hours. I just forget. I'm not gonna even focus on that. It's not. You know, it's just timeless. It felt timeless here. Wow, very great. Okay, I'm gaining weight again, but maybe it's muscle because I felt kind of weak and I needed, you know, to put on. I've been working out so much that I felt I needed. I worked out 4 straight days and then I've taken some days off. I just needed to, and kind of needed to eat, and maybe it's I put on, you know, some muscle actually, I hope. Knowing me, it's not. But so I can, I don't know. I don't know what I'll do. I have no idea. No idea. I'll just, whatever happens, let it remind me that wow, it causes happiness. Okay. Just a reminder that wow causes happiness. So how is Longchenpa going to structure my days so that I have all these reminders that wow causes happiness? That's all I have to look forward to, right? That's what I have to look forward to. And he will structure your days. Just ask him, or whatever your Dharma king is. Just ask them to structure your days so that you're reminded that you're, you know, I, for instance, is the cause of happiness. I. Oh yeah, I is the cause of happiness. That's right. Whatever your type is, or I am is the cause of happiness, or yeah, or aha, or wow, like that. Whatever your word is, your just simple mantra, your one word mantra, or could be I am. It's like just one word, just one concept. I am is the one thing. That is it. Let your life be structured. So allow, free your world. So now it's just working for you instead of against you. Instead of searching elsewhere, it's now all completely working for you to remind you of that one word that's causing, one cause of your happiness. That one cause. Wow. Is the one cause of my happiness, and nothing else causes it all. Wow, totally causes all my happiness, and it's total happiness. That's it. Wow. So, very great, and I will now see what Longchenpa has next for us, for me at least, and I'll pass it on, maybe, right? If it's relevant, I'll pass it on. Very great. That's it for this one. Wow. I hit the wrong button, but that's okay. It'll stop anyway. Stop catcher.